So with this, I would like to introduce Jens Malbach. Many of you will remember Jens from 2 years ago at Kin Global because he's really friggin' tall, but also a fabulous fellow. Jens founded Coinstar, Redbox, now Otterwall, and now he's for the past couple of years onto a new mission called Win-Win, and it truly is win-win. Jens,
thanks, Mark.
Welcome back.
I'm still tall. Nice to see you all. I actually didn't found Redbox. I left Coinstar before it acquired Redbox, but I can tell you lots of Coinstar stories at the break if you'd like to know them. So what I'm looking forward to sharing with this morning is how we think about our little corner of igniting impact and co-creating a future that we all want to see with some foresight. So at Win-Win, we think a lot about what we call tri-sector innovation. So how do we harness the best assets from companies and nonprofits and governments in a collaborative way to help solve the problems that we'd all like to see solved in the world? And the problem with the problems, when we think about it, is that they're complex, they're hard, homelessness, affordable housing, and they're multifaceted, and they're expensive. The UN's global goals have been estimated to require $5 to $7 trillion a year of annual incremental spending to be able to solve all the social problems in the world. And that number can be scaled down to the size of a country, or to a state, or to a city or a community. So you can think about that number that's relevant to your local area. But the challenge with the financing of that is it's a lot of money, and we're highly unlikely to be able to grow the economy fast enough to generate enough money to solve the problems we all want to see solved. And we're certainly not going to donate enough money. And we're not going to tax ourselves enough. So there's a real question about how do we solve these complex problems with a lack of resources. The other thing we think about is that if you look at kind of the whole economy, you think about companies and nonprofits and governments, there's actually a lot of resources there, but we're not optimized to harness the resources across the sectors. So the framework we use at Win-Win is what can we do about that? And these are the four elements that we think about, and everything we do hangs on these four things. So I'm gonna walk through the framework briefly, then I'm gonna talk about a couple of use cases, then I'm gonna talk about the system that we're creating to help enable this at scale. So the first piece of this is, if you think about that financing problem, if there's not enough new money, then it seems to us the only way to solve the problems is to repurpose the existing resources that have already been built and the existing money that's already been spent. If you think about the size of the economy of what's already being spent, all of a sudden there's plenty of money. So how do we repurpose existing resources from governments, nonprofits, and companies? And then how do we align them in really interesting ways so we can get to the solutions we all want to see? And an important component of this framework, we believe, is self-interest. Because we're interested in companies showing up not just for their CSR interests, but for their core business interests. And we want nonprofits being part of this because they're actually serving their clients. We want government programs and agencies there because they're serving their core interests as citizens. So harnessing that power of self-interest so that we think it would be sustainable at scale over the long haul. But it's all been done through a common lens and a common set of benefits. So that's the framework. The first case study I want to share with you is Coinstar, which is the company I founded now 27 years ago, which is shocking to me. And the quick story here is I was a grad student. And I obviously had a jar of coins at home, and I got curious about it. So I wrote to the Fed and I wrote to the Mint, and what I learned was that we had manufactured $15 billion worth of physical coin stock in the US to support the economy. But of that $15 billion, only $8 billion was actually in circulation, and $7 billion was actually just sitting on dresser tops. So I thought, oh, okay, there's $7 billion sitting out there, maybe we can kind of get some of that back into the economy. But then I'd taken a macro course in business school, so I realized that the $8 billion that circulated turned over 20 times a year and created a $150 billion market. And I thought, that's a pretty good sized market for doing a startup. But then I thought about other elements too, because I wanted my work to have meaning. So I thought, how can we not only have a great private sector company, but work collaboratively with the social sector? And I realized that coins and charity had a long history, March of Dimes, Salvation Army with collecting money with the red buckets at holidays, or UNICEF with the orange boxes at Halloween. Anybody ever do the UNICEF program? Collect those hands going on. So I thought, oh, we can make machines in terms of, you know, donation collection events. And then I thought about government. Could we do something to be useful to government? And I realized if we got all those old coins back into circulation and we sped up the velocity of the coins in the system, we could actually reduce manufacturing and distribution costs for the government. So that's what happened. Over the years, Coinstar has processed more coins than McDonald's has cooked, I'd like to say. So a trillion and a half coins have gone through the network now, about 45 billion. But what I'm most proud about is we've actually raised about $100 million for nonprofits. And we've saved the US government billions of dollars. The nonprofit story is fun. There's lots of examples about it, but my favorite is UNICEF actually called us in the late 90s. And they said, hey, you know about those orange boxes and all the kids go out and collect them? And they said, we have a problem because the kids don't send us the money back, or if they do, we actually have to count all those coins. So what we did is we actually said, just bring those boxes to Coinstar, we'll have the kids punch in a code, we'll wire transfer the funds to you directly at half the cost. And it became one of the most cost-effective forms of fundraising they'd ever seen. And similarly with the US government, I got a call from the Fed, which was a little scary in the late 90s. We just rolled out of LA, and they said, who are you and what are you doing? And we're like, we're this little company in Seattle. And they said, the West Coast Fed just canceled all future penny orders. Will you please come explain yourself? So we flew to DC and we explained ourselves. And they were fascinated by what we were doing, because we were saving them all this money. Instead of a production and distribution system, we created this recycling phenomenon. And they couldn't regulate us or anything, but said, how can we work with you? And we're like, you don't have to do anything. You've already created the market. But the way the Coinstar benefited is when we came time for international expansion, we got a call from the Mint in the UK. And they called us up and said, hey, we hear you're saving the US a lot of money. Will you come do the same thing for us in the UK? So I flew over and I met them, and they loved it. And they made all the introductions, and we rolled out the UK in 6 months. And without that public sector support, there's no way my private sector company would have ever been able to harness that ability. So the lesson I took out of Coinstar, and this is the old lesson, was you can actually take assets from all three sectors and combine them in ways that are synergistic and create the win-win. So looking forward, this is how we think about the world, this is how we think about businesses, and we think the opportunity is huge. I'd like to tell you about another case study, a company called Propel in New York. Has anybody heard of Propel? Okay, great. It's happening slowly. You'll hear a lot more about it. Since you don't know what Propel is, I'll tell you it's a small disruptive startup, and they have a powerful market. 45 million unique users who have $70 billion of spending power, and somebody built a cloud database where you can track all that spending that you can access for free. If I were to ask you to guess the market, you probably wouldn't guess if it's food stamps. It's stunning to me that one in seven Americans is food insecure, which is twice the number it was 10 years ago. And I find that amazing for the country that we are, and disappointing. But rather than having the political debate about the food stamp program, which is called SNAP, is there a way to solve this with a win-win approach, which is what Propel has done? So they've created an app that actually serves food stamp users. They've had over 700,000 downloads now in the last 7 months. And it helps them get additional spending power, gets access to social services and public sector services. It's really hot, you're gonna hear a lot about it, and at scale, we think it can save the US government billions of dollars by using this approach. So what do? They actually use this tri-sector win-win approach. So in the private sector, you can download this app, it's called FreshEBT, it's free to the food stamp user, we call her Maria. And Maria gets money from the government on a debit card essentially once a month. And she gets on average $250, and that she runs out in about 2 weeks. So it's really important for Maria to know what her balance is. And before Propel, the way she gets her balance is when she checks out at the supermarket, her balance is printed at the bottom of the receipt, which is great because she knows how much money she has. But the problem comes, it comes at exactly the wrong time she's done shopping. So Maria will go buy a soda or a candy bar before she goes shopping so she can get her balance so she can then shop and avoid that potentially embarrassing moment at the checkout. Well, these guys used design thinking and figured this out, and they said, well, can we just create an app and give Maria her balance? So that's what they've done. So they can show Maria that she has $58 left on her card here. We're also now doing welfare balances. The surprising thing is when they downloaded the balance, they actually got her entire purchase history for all the stores she shops at. So they actually have access to market share data on up to $70 billion of spending in the supermarket industry, which is kind of an interesting asset when you think about it from a private sector business. So what they do is they can take those data sets on behalf of Maria, and they can make her visible and valuable to the retailers and the manufacturers, and we think we can generate about $100 of extra spending power through additional discounts in the store, which is a really cool business model. Propel could have stopped here with what they're doing, it's really terrific. But using the win-win model, we pushed them further. So they started to incorporate other elements of public sector assets. So here they geolocate where Maria is, and they can show her exactly which stores accept the SNAP benefits. But you'll notice there's a program here called Summer Meals and also one called Farmers Markets. Why do we put those on the app? Well, it turns out the government has a program that feeds her kids free breakfast and free lunch in the summer. We geolocated every one of those locations in the country to make it easy for Maria to feed her kids. In addition, we put farmers markets on there because most cities have programs that will double the value of your SNAP benefits if you buy fresh vegetables. The program isn't well known, so now we tell Maria where her money can go further and where she can spend it. It's really cool. And the last thing we do is we geolocate social sector, and we actually help Maria find out where she can get childcare, nutrition counseling, job training, and a whole variety of resources that she needs. I can tell you a lot about Propel, but the point that I want to make here is that if you're Maria, you actually need resources from all three sectors for your life to work well. And if you're Propel, the company, you're actually using resources for the other two sectors to build a stronger business. Think about it from the business angle. Try to compete against this company unless you're using the resources from all three sectors. It's hard to do. You actually build a better business with this tri-sector innovation lens. So what do we learn from Coinstar and Propel? In both cases, you have a large federal market. In my case, $150 billion coin market. In Propel's case, a $70 billion program from the Department of Agriculture. But when you look broadly at the landscape, there are thousands of government programs and social programs out there, and the scale and the spending is huge. We think many of them are opportunities to do this repurposing and realignment of the assets. And one of the exciting things for us that we've realized, it's not about just disruptive startups like Propel and like Coinstar, but also large companies. And we're now talking to Fortune 100 companies, Fortune 500 companies. So when we talk to companies, both small and large, and get them thinking this way, we ask them three questions. And all of you can play along here. If you have a private sector company, you can do this. If you're a nonprofit, you're a government, you can do this. And the questions we ask aren't hard, but they get people thinking. So if you're a private sector company, we ask you, what's your private sector strategy? And they all have good answers to this. You go to business school, you learn how to do strategies. Then we ask them, what's their social sector strategy? How do you work collaboratively with a 501c3? And we're not talking about donations. What do you do with your core business that's in the 501c3's self-interest? Many companies don't have good answers to this, but a few do. And the last question we ask a company is, what's your public sector strategy? How do you work with government? And the standard answers are, we don't work with government, they're bad for business, we try to avoid taxes, we don't want to get regulated, and we want to lobby. Those are the ones that come up all the time. And we're like, you're thinking about it all wrong. Turn it on its head. If you could have access to any resource in the public sector, anything that government has built or does at the city, county, state, or federal levels, would any of those assets be good for your business? And companies say, what are you talking about? I'm like, well, I found a $150 billion market in my pocket full of pennies. Are you interested in that? Propel found a $70 billion market in the Department of Agriculture. And slowly we get companies to wake up to think about this tri-sector lens and what you can do with that. So as we've thought about this, we think the opportunity set is huge. So to scale this and bring them out, we've actually created a system solutions, most of which is being implemented in this 501c3 we call Win-Win. And there's four components to it. Our main goal is to both inspire and enable organizations to find and deliver and execute on these tri-sector strategies. But we also think it's important that the investment community sees this as a strong and powerful investment thesis. So the four components are these. I'm just going to give you kind of a quick snapshot on them. We have this part called Identify, where we help companies to identify these tri-sector assets. We have two tools called Rants and Raise and Expert Spotlighting, so we can see what the issues and what the problems are, so we get feedback from the market. We're building this collaborative online database called the Win-Win Wiki that actually organizes the assets of all three sectors, which I'll show you here in a second. We believe in the power of storytelling, which we think can be transformative so companies get what we're doing. We're building an innovation engine so that both accelerators and incubators and large companies can think about how do we actually do this, because it actually takes some practice to learn to do this tri-sector innovation. And then lastly, we talk to the investment community. And these are some of my favorite conversations. When I talk to my friends who are hedge fund managers, runs private equity shops or venture capital firms, I ask them what they do, and they tell me their overview, and I know a lot of them. And I say, you know, it's interesting to me that you're investing your private sector dollars in private sector companies and you get good returns, would you ever consider investing in a private sector company that got access to some free assets from the social sector or the government sector and actually got higher returns? In fact, if you're investing in companies that don't use assets from the other two sectors, you're actually sub-optimizing what your capabilities are. And they look at me a little bit crazy, and I go through the stories, and I'm like, oh, this actually makes sense from a business return, and we think this can be a strong, compelling investment thesis. I mentioned the wiki. I'm just going to give you a quick overview of this. We think the important thing is to be able to figure out how to do this, because it's not obvious where these assets are, so they need to get organized. So we're actually mapping this out in all three sectors. And we use a couple of tools to do this. Matthew Bishop, who's in the back, is the founder of the Social Progress Index. We think it's a terrific framework that helps both track and measure progress. We use it as an impact lens to help organize the assets that are out there. We also use the global goals. And both with the global goals and the SPI, we ask basic questions like, who's on the team? Who's working on affordable housing? Who's working on maternal mortality? Who's working on the adult literacy rate? So what we've done is we've gone through, and we've done this now in three states in the US, and we're coming to more, coming to Chicago this summer. And we actually take cities, counties, and state-level governments, we're now working on the federal piece, and we summarize their goods and services, and we tag them to the outcomes. And then we do the same thing with the social sector, and the same thing with the private sector. So I could tell you who in Washington State is actually working on any of these impact areas and what their resources are. And it builds a tool for innovators to see who's on their team. So we can answer questions. In this case, you can see the depth of the food deficit and where in the city of Seattle these assets are. And you'll see the programs like Fresh Bucks that doubles the value of the SNAP benefits and the Summer Meals program, which Propel executed. We also track things like where's the money? So we've mapped out almost $3 trillion worth of spending so we can tell where the resources are, and we track outcomes. I can give you more details on this later. The interesting thing to us is we think this scales beautifully. So we did this last year in Washington State with the University of Washington, Stanford did California, Harvard did Massachusetts. We're really excited to have been contacted by INCAI in Costa Rica, so they've applied the win-win wiki modeling to Costa Rica. We're going to be going to Oxford soon. And we just received a grant from General Motors Foundation, so we launched Detroit 2 days ago, and we're coming to Chicago, and we're launching here with both Kellogg and Booth this summer. So we're excited to be here. We're looking forward to working with all of you on Trisect Innovation if you're local. What's interesting to us when we come to a city is we have one single goal, which is we really want to drive progress, right? And you can measure that economically or socially or environmentally, right? We do that through this lens of trisector innovation. So when we show up in a city like Chicago, we do four things. We localize that win-win toolkit, those online resources. We talk a lot to the stakeholders. We work with the innovators, and we introduce this concept of trisector innovation. And then importantly, we talk to the investment community so there can be capital that can flow into these organizations out there. At scale, we think this can actually get quite big quite quickly. Over the next 5 years, we plan to roll out 300 cities globally and create what we call these win-win ecosystems. We think there can be hundreds of new companies like Propel and like Coinstar that adopt this piece. But we think what's even more powerful is to get existing organizations to start thinking about these tri-sector strategies so they can really drive both profit and impact at scale. Those three questions, what's your private, what's your social, what's your public sector strategy, we think are fundamental. We'd love to see every board meeting being open with those in every sector. And those questions apply not only if you're a private sector company, but try asking them if you're a nonprofit. What's your private sector strategy or what's your government strategy if you're a nonprofit? And can you imagine a government asking, what's my private sector strategy that's not about taxation or regulation, that's actually trying to work collaboratively with the private sector to generate the outcomes we all want to see. We think there can be thousands of new leaders. Universities are a key part of our distribution system, and by running these programs with the universities and cities over time, we think we can train thousands of leaders to think with this trisector lens. And our goal at the end of the day is to channel massive resources towards both economic and social progress. That's the framework. The key thing about the framework is mindset shift. So if we can all start thinking about this in different ways and starting to think like, how can I work collaboratively with the other sectors in a win-win manner? And maybe we can create what I like to call a win-win world. And that's the world that I want.